we determine whom we are and whose we are. Let me just say, I'm thankful even on tonight that there's a home laid up for me in heaven when I die. I'm grateful for that. Can 10 people say amen? Amen. I'm grateful that there will be a perfect mansion someday in the very presence of God. However, right now, I'm still living in planet Earth. Can 10 people say amen? Amen. And I need, I don't know about you, but I need some practical help for my day-to-day walk with God. Anybody with me? I need help to take this spiritual law and make it practical that I may apply it to my life so that I can be effective in the things that which is spiritual. Can you say amen? There are blessings from God that are spiritual that money cannot buy. And I want to be able to utilize them, the fruit of the Spirit, that I may be all that God called me to be. So I want to talk about that. These two verses of this chapter give us some insight into an area of how or why we should walk with God. They tell us the secret. Here it is. Shout this with me. Of holy living. Say that. Holy living. The secret. So essentially tonight, if I may, I want us to plug into the power of surrender. Shout that. Yeah. Surrender. Man, when I came up from in the rehab, they had this motto called surrender to win. Surrender to win. Can you say that? You know about that, Eric? Say it. Surrender to win. It doesn't mean that I can't fight. It just means I stop fighting. Right? If I surrender that I cannot manage my life with the use of drugs, I surrender to it and I win. Sometimes you have to surrender your life to some things that you know you have no control over. And when you do that, God will allow you to continue to win. So the first point we see, it's on the screen. Shout this with me. The worship of God. Please, Kenny, we spend too much money just to have a black screen. Find me something. Spend too much money just to have a black screen. The worship, and it ought to be moving. Is it moving? Yep. Yeah. Thank God. Say that with me. The worship of God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. So look at Romans 12, verse 1. The worship of God is on the screen. Let's read this together. Come on. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, can you read? Your bodies. And the people of God says, amen. Amen. I thought nobody could read but Jody. Amen. And everybody start filling in. Thank God for you, man. I appreciate you. The worship of God. We want to deal with that. The worship of God. Here Paul tells us that the yielding of our bodies to the Lord, watch this, it's on the screen, is our reasonable service. In other words, to do that, it's a standard. It's our standard. The word reasonable comes from the same word, it's going to bless you, stay with me, from which we get our word logic. Reasonable logic. So the first thing we see in the text is that the yielding of our bodies to the Lord is logical. Are y'all with me? In other words, it just makes sense that a God who has given us his all, it makes perfect sense, Ray, to give him everything that we have. We see here the law of reciprocity. God is faithful unto us. Can 10 people say amen? Amen. And we ought to give him everything we have, and that's the reasonable, that's the standard of our service. Reasonable service. It's logical. Say that, logical. Then the word service comes from a word which means, it's on the screen, to perform sacred service. There we go again, Kenny. What are you doing? You're playing back there. To perform sacred service. Are y'all seeing this? That's my nephew. Don't play on no mind. We do this all the time. It's connected. Listen, you got to get this. It's connected to the idea of worship. Therefore, this phrase means that yielding our bodies to the Lord, watch this, is our logical service of worship before the Lord. It's logical. It makes sense of yielding our bodies. In other words, this statement right here is summed up in two words. Show up. Can you say amen? Show up. And you're going to see some challenges about showing up in a minute. Therefore, this phrase means that the yielding of the bodies is logical. In other words, when we are totally yielded to him, it's the highest form of worship. Not when we tawda, not when we yada, not when we tahilya, not when we barak or shabak. The highest form of worship is yielding your bodies unto him. Not bowing down when we in worship, singing songs. There are great worship experiences, but the highest form of worship is when we are totally yielded unto God. Nothing says I love you to the Lord like a consecrated, dedicated, holy life. In other words, worship is a lifestyle. Come on, y'all. I know this is elementary, but we got to be reminded. It's a lifestyle. It comes from the Greek word doxa, from which we get our word doxology. Doxa means anything that brings glory unto God. When I yield my bodies unto God, that is the idea of worship. It's the highest form of worship. When I'm yielding, when I'm dedicated, when my life is holy, God gets glory out of a holy life. And let me point my finger right here for a minute and just pause. Because oftentimes in my 11 years of preaching and pastoring, I've seen many people come back and they be crying how life has turned on them and how their husband left them or their boo ran out on them or their children tripping or their job messed up. And they come in crying on my shoulder and begin to speak in a tongue and everything. And they say, Pastor, I want to rededicate my life. Well, you can't rededicate until you were dedicated. Come on, say amen. So many people don't need to come back to rededicate. They need to come back and dedicate in the first place. Because when you dedicate yourself to the Lord, amen, God will get glory and he will keep you in the midst of pathos. Come on, y'all, and pain in your present life. So dedication ought to be a thing that we look for to give God glory. A consecrated life, a sanctified life, a set apart life. Come from among them. Be ye separated. Be ye holy as I am holy. God says that life right there brings me glory. That's the idea of worship. When I'm walking right, when I'm talking right, when I'm treating my neighbor right. Y'all need to talk to me. That's worship at its best. That's when worship really wins. So the text talks about service. It's the idea of worship. Look what John 14:15 says. And I want to remind you again, I said it earlier. If you love me, keep my commandments. Live holy. Live righteous if you love me. I love you, Lord, and I lift my voice. Hey, I love you, Lord, and I lift my life. Come on. I lift my life to the standard that wherever I am, not only in church, but wherever I am, I give you glory. Come on, say amen. If you short at church, I know you're short everywhere else in terms of living your life. If you don't even show up for church, I know you're not showing up for God anywhere else, because it starts at his church. That's right, at his house. Good student. So with this in mind, let's look at the first verse and see what Paul means when he calls on us to yield our bodies. Let's look at it, how he calls us. First of all, it's on the screen. There's a challenge. Sometimes it's a downright challenge to show up. Amen. I mean, a challenge. Everything and its mama gets in your way to get to the house of God. Come on, say amen. It almost wants you to turn around unless your fire is lit. And when you're around a long time and it becomes mundane and monotonous, amen, sometimes those distractions deter you from doing what God has called you to do, and that's to present your bodies a living sacrifice. We are called to present your bodies. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies. Are y'all getting anything? Yes. Now, the word present means to place at one's disposal, which means you don't have a choice in the matter. You are at the disposal of God himself. For far too many miss this because it has an idea, watch this, of total surrender unto God. Total surrender. You're going to see it. It's going to bless you. Far too many people want to be saved, but not willing to lay everything on the altar. Which means they're guilty of holding back areas of their lives that are precious to them. I can't hear nobody. I give you this, Lord, but I can't give you that. I got to keep that, but I give you this. I'm going to stop smoking, but I can't stop clubbing right now. I'm going to come to church, but right now I still can't speak to so-and-so. But God is calling us to totally, watch this, surrender our entire bodies and our life, our being unto him. We are to be at his disposal. I need somebody to shout hallelujah. Hallelujah. Can I help somebody? And you promise you'll shout? God wants it all. Amen. Everything you are, you ought to be completely his. Everything that you're not, everything that you got belongs to God. And God says, when you are willing to give it all to me, I'm willing to give me all to you. Amen. Come on, y'all. It's a law of reciprocity. God says, listen, show me what you're working with. Right. Amen. Yield your bodies unto me. Give everything to me. Be willing to give fornication to me. Be willing to give your lust to me. Be willing, come on, y'all, to give backbiting and slandering. Come on, say amen. Be willing to give it all to me, and I promise you, when you lay it at my hand, I am a deliverer. Amen. Come on, say amen. Amen. You just have to have the desire, praise God, to want to change. Right. God says, listen, you don't have to change right away. If you have the desire, I'll work with you. Right. Come on, I'll walk with you. Right. Glory to God. He walks with me. He talks with me. Right. He tells me, I wish I had a Baptist church. I'm his own. There go church over there. Glory. And the joy that we share. Glory to God. See, you got to get to the place where you understand that God loves you so much. He don't want you tied down with anything but him. That's right. God Almighty. And when you get tied down with God and tangled up with God, God will do some things in your life that will blow your mind. Can 10 people say amen? So in the worship of God, there's a challenge. Also, in the worship of God, Sabrina, there is a cause. There's a challenge, and then there is a cause. Notice the phrase. Look at the screen. Therefore, by the what? Mercies of God. The challenge is to present your bodies. The cause is by the mercies of God. Somebody shout, cause. Now, if your neighbor don't shout, after this clause right here, I don't want you to talk to them no more tonight because they're going to miss the word. May we never forget we were on our way to hell when God found us. But the mercy, here's a cause for you. We can shout right through here. We didn't care a thing about God, but he loved us. He died to save us. He convicted and called and changed us. He gave us the faith to believe. Let me run that by you right there. He gave us the faith to believe. For the scripture says we were dead in sins and trespasses. Come on, y'all. Where we walked according to the course of the world. We were dead. We could not even respond to any stimuli. God had to give us the faith to believe in him. Come on, say amen. We were dead in sins. We couldn't have no response. We were, watch this, irresponsible in our response because we were dead. But he was so gracious to give us faith to believe. And he saved us. Watch this. Here's your place to shout. By his grace. Yeah. For we were on our way to hell. But God, who is rich. Come on, y'all. In mercy, wherewith he loved us with this great love. I need about 15 of y'all tonight to know that you were on your way to hell. You deserve to go to hell, but God stepped in, spoke to you. Y'all not helping me. Come on, we didn't chase God, but God found us. The scripture says you didn't choose God, but God chose you before the foundation of the world. He adopted you. He had a plan for you. You were out of the commonwealth of Israel. You were strangers. You were alienation of this commonwealth of Israel. But God, glory to God, he saw something in you. Look beyond your faults and saw your needs. And not only did he see your your need, but he met your need. My God shall supply every need. I ain't got no help here. I need somebody to shout right now. You were on your way to hell, but look at you now. You're still here, and you ought to testify that God is still good. We were lost, we were corrupted, we were conniving, but thanks be to God, God showed up and gave us a victory. That's why I lift up my hands. That's why I do my dance. That's why every time I get a flashback when I was a low down, good for nothing, scum of the earth, backbiting, whoremonger, sinner on my way to hell, but he still loved me right there where I am. You need to touch your neighbor and tell your neighbor, you should have saw me where I was, but get a good look at me now. I wasn't always this fine. I didn't always look this good. I didn't always smell y'all quiet here, but look at God. He turned that finger around. High five your neighbor and tell your neighbor, you get a good look at me right now, because I'm not going to be looking like this much longer, because God got a plan for me and he's going to do it very quickly. And I need you to shout in advance to make God expedite that blessing, because you don't know, like I know, I'm preaching already, how God brought me out, how God brought me in, kept my enemies away from me, didn't let me die, how the enemy tried to kill me even last week, but God blocked it. He put a standard in front of me, and that's why I shout hallelujah. By the mercies of God. I don't know about y'all, but it seems to me that we owe him everything. Therefore, by the mercies of God. Tell somebody, there's a cause. There's a cause why I ought to show up. He's been good to me. Hallelujah. By the mercies of God, I'm going to present my body. I don't care if I don't feel like it. Mercy gets in my head. I don't care. I'm quiet here. By the mercies of God. So may we, like Paul, ever be aware of the fact that I am what I am by the grace of God. Therefore, by the mercies of God. So then, in the worship of God, there's a challenge, right? Present your bodies. There's a cause. Therefore, by the mercies of God. And then on the screen, here we go, there's a consecration. Am I doing all right? There's a challenge. Present your bodies. There's a cause by the mercies of God. And then there's a consecration. We are told that these bodies, listen, are to be presented. It's on the screen. Say it real loud. A living sacrifice. Consecrated. There's a challenge. There's a challenge. Present your bodies. That's a challenge. Amen. There's a cause. And I thank God because of the mercies of God. But then there's a consecration. A living sacrifice. Now in the Old Testament, Dwayne, let me just stop here and kind of teach. Their sacrifice was to die, but our sacrifice is to live. Are y'all getting that? They were sacrifice pigeons and doves and unblemished lambs for the people of God. The sacrifice, it was dead, but our sacrifice is a living. Our sacrifice is to live, a living sacrifice. While that is true, there are also some similarities. Watch this. Get the teaching between our sacrifice and theirs, the Old Testament. The Lord is commanding each of us to make it costly, personal, and necessary. Man, this is great teaching. A living sacrifice means that we are to be on the altar wherever we are. I can't hit nobody. Amen. Not only when you in the church house, your altar ought to be wherever you are, that you are a living, God Almighty, sacrifice. Regardless of the geographical surroundings, we are to remember that this body, that body that you have, belongs to God. Yeah. When you get saved, you no longer belong to yourself. Say this, I belong to another. Say it again, I belong to another. Once you get saved, you do not belong to you. You can't have half of you. Everything about you belongs to God. You are at his total disposal. I want you to get this. There's no bargaining with God, for he have bought you with a price. You are a bond slave, and that's different than a regular slave. A bond slave is really free. But watch this. They desire to come back to the master. You missed it. See, when you are a regular slave, you are in bondage. You have to do what the master says. A bond slave, watch this, is a slave that is free but volunteers to follow the master. God Almighty. I free you to go. You're free. For whom the Son set free is free and free indeed. You're free. You're my slave. But because I love you, I still come back and serve you. God Almighty, that's good stuff. You don't belong to yourself. Say it again. I now belong to another. You don't have a choice in the matter. There was a price. The Bible says Adam sold us into sin, and Jesus had to become the one who actually became the payment for us so that we could have a relationship with God. Can I say that again? Jesus had to become the actually one, the payment for us so we could have a relationship with God. He bought us with the price. We no longer belong to ourselves. A living sacrifice means a constant, continuous sacrifice. A living sacrifice means that the body sacrificed its own desires for those of God. A living sacrifice means, watch this, that the body is devoted to the task of serving. Devoted. So the bottom line is that the sacrificing of the body is something one does in the is not something one does in the church only. Amen. After you leave church, how you living?
Amen to that.
You got it? After the service is over, after the shout is over, after the song is over, in your secret living, are you a living sacrifice? If we could put your life on the screens after you leave the church, would we consider your life a sacrifice living? Could we connect your life to being to God's disposal? Or we will see some of you in you. That's the challenge. This is not an easy word, because many of us have been in the world longer than we've been living saved. I didn't say saved, I said living saved. Because when you get saved right, you ought to live right. And after you have the Holy Ghost and have enough power, watch this, to put your flesh in control, you should win more than you did before you received Holy Ghost. I didn't say you ought to win because you have this flesh desire, not these bodies I'm talking about. I'm talking about the flesh desire, the sinful nature that's bent on sin inside of you. It's not you, it's inside of you. Paul said, it's sin that dwelleth on the inside of me. It's not me. Every one of you, watch this. Don't never get big-headed. Watch this, because God will test you and the enemy will tempt you with the very thing he knows that you like. Come on, you're not above it, because it's the sin, Paul says, that lives in me. There's no good thing that dwelleth in my flesh, inside of me. So you're fighting every day. You're warring, but now you've been given some power through the new man, but the old man is always at constant war with the new man. Have I got a witness here? And if you get on it, sometimes the old man wins. Come on, 2 weeks ago, you cussed that woman out in your mind. Y'all quiet. Through your mouth. I love an honest church. Come on, say amen. Sometimes you go through the fight. It's a challenge. It's war. It's war going on daily. When you wake up in the morning, your new man and old man is fighting. Come on, say amen. Watch this. And whoever is the strongest is going to win. So if you feeding your ego, your pride, your flesh, and you're not reading your word, you're not a devoted servant of God, you don't have a worship life, come on, say amen. You don't have any spiritual jumping jacks. So when a war comes on, somebody has to win. Somebody going to make that decision. Do I go after her or do I sit in my car? And sometimes the grace of God keeps you because somebody looking.
That's right.
That's just the grace of God. Because if nobody was looking, you would have went. And did it. And came back if you could cover it. That's why many people walk in church with a conviction that's so heavy. They come in with a cry, a cloud over their head, but their hands still lifted. And you ought to give God praise that you can still lift your hands. Because the grace of God gives you the conviction to know that it ain't me that's been keeping me.
That's right.
I paused right there to help somebody. Did I help anybody right there?
Yeah.
Sometimes your flesh, man, just wins.
Yeah.
Don't let anybody tell you, oh, you're above that. Job was a perfect, upright man to shun evil. And then start asking God questions. And God says, where were you when I flung the stars in space? Come on, say amen. Your flesh will get you to challenge and question God. Your flesh will get you to doubt your own faith you got in God. Anybody ever been there?
Oh, yeah.
Keep living in this spiritual life. Glory to God. Life can turn on you. And if you're not connected, if you don't have a good circle, if you don't have people that can staff you, embed you, aid you, support you, pray for you, sometimes you can get in the middle of a crisis, a middle of a war, and can't hear from God. And you think that God have abandoned you, and all you need is one person will come and speak words of life into you and tell you to get up from there. You ain't gonna die, you gonna live. And all of a sudden the word quicken your mortal body. You get back up again. You open your mouth and give God praise. You start lifting up your hands in the sanctuary. Then you start feeling better because the devil tried to... I ain't got no help here. I'm preaching too hard on a Tuesday. What is it? Wednesday night? I'm preaching hard tonight. Glory to God.
Thank God.
Say amen, somebody.
Amen.
So let me get back to this. Watch this. The bottom line is, it's hard, man, to deal with a sacrifice in your body. And you don't do that only in church. It implies that every action, every activity that the body engages in is an activity, watch this, that glorifies and honors God. And sometimes you need to suffer for righteousness' sake.
Amen.
Many people in the church not suffering for righteousness' sake, they're suffering by the bad decisions they made.
Amen.
Come on, say amen.
Amen.
But when you suffer for righteousness' sake, I'm going through and I ain't done nothing. God gets glory. And after you go through, you still don't do nothing.
Amen.
But live righteous. Because every now and then when you go through, it feels like you want to bend to get back.
Right.
Anybody with me here?
Yeah.
Anybody been in this thing long enough? Your flesh be like, nah, I got to do something about this.
Right.
Who do they think they are?
Right.
I come here today to speak and bind and rebuke retaliation.
Amen.
You don't have to retaliate. You don't have to prove nothing. God says vengeance belongs to me. They don't even know what they're doing. That's what the Bible says. If they would have known who Jesus was, they would have never crucified the Lord of glory. Glory to God. But look how Jesus responds, which is our prime example. Father, forgive them. For they know not who they messing with. Y'all quiet here. That's how you got to treat people that will treat you like they don't know. They don't understand. They're bewildered. They're wandering. But you got to be the one that have enough spirituality to understand they not hurting me. They trying to hurt the God in me.
That's right.
And the enemy wants the God in you.
That's right.
Can 10 people say amen? So in the text, Paul tells us how these bodies are to be sacrificed. He gives us two conditions that is the sacrifice must be met. He says, number one, he says, not on screen, he says, holy. Here's the sacrifice. Present your bodies, a living sacrifice. Holy, which means something consecrated and set apart. There ought to be some difference in us. Our appearance ought to be different. Not on the outside. Not the outer appearance. But our walk with God.
Amen.
How we're living. You know what? what success is to me? It's not how much or the amount you have. Success means to me that you have integrity wherever you are. Wherever you are in life. You got $1 million and I got $2. I'm integral with mine, you're not with yours. I'm successful, you're not. Success is what I do when nobody else is looking. Success is, do I work hard when my boss not looking? Or do I brown nose when he gets around? Success is what I do when he's not looking. Success equates my integrity. That's what makes me successful. Not how much money I have, not how much property I have, not how much prestige I have, but what I do with what I do have. Amen. Come on, say amen. Are you successful? That's the question. Are you what you do when you're by yourself? What you do with your money when you're by yourself? Is your relationship successful? Are you still bipping, bobbing, cheating, weaving? Are you successful? This ain't for our church. All our relationships are successful. I pray the Lord in Jesus' name. That's for Facebook. Are you successful? Are you still looking at booty and stuff like that while you still got your gal, your chicks on the side? Huh? Oh, the kids. They should know about that by now. Come on, say they in the right class. They getting up. Somebody better tell him. He hold his mouth like this. He heard that before. He got phones. They got smartphones. Yeah. The smartphone don't know what booty is. It ain't smart. I'm just saying. Am I right about it? Amen. Shoot. I bet I can give him this mic and he can tell me. He'll tell me shy because he don't want his mama to say nothing, but she know too. She know that they know. And if you don't know that they know, you better know. Y'all know what I'm talking about. Then he says acceptable. Present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable. That word acceptable means well-pleasing. It means satisfying. Is God satisfied with how you present yourself? Not in church. God is pleased when a life is sacrificed for his glory. It tells the lost world that God makes a difference. That ties into your witness. Yeah. It tells the world that God makes a difference in the lives he touches. If God touched you, if he really touched you, there ought to be some tangible evidence. There ought to be living positive proof in the way you live. Church talk too much and live raggedy. There ought to be a distinct difference. And I'm not condemning, indicting church. I want to lift us up that we can be better. This message today was let's do better. Let's try to be what God calls us to be, living holy, pleasing, satisfying sacrifices, not only when we're around church people, but what do you do when your kid, are you still cussing your kids out when you get mad? You can improve your, or there shouldn't be an argument with your kids, but you can improve your argument even with your children. Right. Like they yell and scream and holler. Come on, say amen. Amen. What if God yell and scream at you when you make as many mistakes as your children do? Can you say amen? Amen. God is so long suffering with us. Look how long he waited for you to get it right. Amen. What if he would have took his hand off of you before you made it to the presence of God? It took a while for you to make a decision to say, well, you know what, man, I'm going to stop this jive here. I'm going to get myself together and I'm going to work on myself. I'm hungry. I want something. I'm thirsty. The truth of the matter is, many of us, if we were caught right now, would deserve to be indicted right now. Many of us walked in here with some hidden stuff. But the grace of God, the mercies, the cause of God, why I show up so much, because he kept me through it all. Are y'all getting this? So the secret of holy living and plugging in the power of surrender, it revolves around the worship of God. And secondly, it revolves around the wisdom of God. 8:05, been an hour. The wisdom of God.
On screen, nephew, Kenny.
What y'all doing? Is it up there? The wisdom of God. What you doing, man? y'all don't have nothing but what? Oh, y'all doing something on the TriCaster? Same time. Come on, son. Stay on the pro presenter. It's three of y'all back there. Ain't got been Doug just babysitting the board. He ain't got but one mic. He can get off the board and sit right there. He come over here and sit by his wife. Talk back to me if you can.
Amen.
Can you say amen? I shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I'm not getting on him. It's just now working on his attention and his focus. Because little Kenny ever get focused, he's going to be, oof, Jesus. Oh, God, what he was doing. He probably, this is a word for you. You help so many people, you miss helping yourself sometimes. Don't let helping everybody else keep you short. Are you hearing me?
Amen.
It's not selfish to want to take care of yourself. Probably trying to help Tori and train Tori and miss this cue. You got the audience calling for you. All right?
Amen.
Say this, y'all, the wisdom of God.
The wisdom of God.
We dealt with the worship of God, and then we're going to deal with the wisdom of God. Romans 12. Yes.
We're trying to help him.
You're trying to help him.
Amen.
Tori tried to help him. Wow. Jesus Christ. Tori trying to help him. Is that the truth, Dwayne?
Yep.
Jesus. Good God Almighty.
God.
Come on, Kenny. You the trainer. He helping you. Pal, go back there and rub his back or something. No, sit right there. Go sit right there.
That's mama for you. That's mama.
All right, Romans 12. Second verse. And be not conformed to this world, but what? I'm about to close this service. I see that right now. This ain't working. I done lost my audience. The people of God says, amen. Y'all ready? What I'm going to do with them, Jordan? Paul moves from dealing with the body, listen, y'all, to dealing with the mind. Y'all see that transition? I don't want y'all to miss this teaching, because the teaching is still responsible for you to get anywhere. Whatever distraction it is, you retain this information. You need to start taking notes if you can't watch it online, because these notes are going to help you when you can put them together.
Yeah.
He goes from the worship of God that deals with your body, then he goes to the wisdom of God that deals with your mind. Be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. Listen, here is the root of our problems anyway. Because at the end of the day, when we can get the mind to think as it should, then the body will obediently get in check. Here's where the connection is. You have to see it, because in the matter of conquering the mind, we are commanded, listen, it's on the screen, be not conformed to this world. Be not conformed to this world. That word world in the Greek comes from the word cosmos, the systems of men. Be not transformed to the systems of men. It means also, it's on the screen, to fashion or to shape. Systems, to fashion or to shape. It literally means to, here it is, to mold. We talked about that one night about who's molding you. Something is shaping you.
Right, right.
You just need to make sure it's God that's shaping you. An accurate translation is, be not molded to these systems of men, this world system. We are not to allow this world to squeeze us, y'all, into its mold. Now notice he says, be not, before he says, be this. I teach us this all the time. Be not before he says, be this. The text says, be not, be not. Because he knows the mind automatically copes the way it normally copes. So before he tells you what to be, he says, be not that. Right? To get your mind to thinking. Because he knows most of us react the same way. If they cuss at you, he knows this. So he says, be not like that. You know what I mean? He knows when people cut you off and don't get a blinker and on their phone, he knows you're trying to chase them. Can you say amen? Be not a chaser. That's just for some of us. Everybody else not. You know, you know what yours is. Put your be not before yours. Everybody got one. I'd be all night trying to figure it out because you ain't going to be honest to tell me what it really is, but be not that whatever yours is. Huh? We are not to allow the world to make us like it is. You see, the world and those who are controlled by its influence are vastly different from that which God intends men to be. This is made clear by a list of some of the works of the flesh as listed in Galatians. Put that on the screen, Galatians 5. Now the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these. Let's read them. Go. Adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, eliminations, wrath, strife, seditions, heresies, envies, murderers, drunkenness, rebellions, such like, of the which I tell you before, as I have also told you in time past, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. People, God says it. We ought to avoid being squeezed into the world's mold. Tell somebody we must be different and remain different. Then we are commanded to be, it's on the screen, transformed by the renewing of your mind. He's paying attention now. He on it. 10 people say, man, his mind has been captured again. Now that word transform gives us our English word metamorphosis. Say that, it's on the screen.
Metamorphosis.
It describes the transformation of caterpillar goes through to become a butterfly. The caterpillar and the butterfly are the same creature. But when the caterpillar enters the cocoon, the part of the insect that resides on the inside is allowed to be manifest on the outside. And watch this, sometimes if you allow the butterfly to get out the cocoon too early, right, the wings will be too lighty, too weak to even fly. Which means, likewise, unto us, sometimes God won't allow us out of our crucible too early because he's trying to give us enough strength so when we come out, we can fly. But it's a metamorphosis that God uses. But when the caterpillar enters it, comes out, he comes out another creature. And that's the change God wants to prescribe in each of us. He moves into our hearts when he saves us. Now, we must remember that this flesh will do what the mind tells it to do. He wants to transform the mind, the soulish part of man, so that the flesh might be changed. It's only when the mind is changed. Are y'all getting this? And brought under the power of God that the flesh can be brought under the control. That's why the proverbial writer says, as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. The way you think will determine the way you act. So how is this accomplished? I'm glad you asked. By surrendering the will to God. Here it is, by filling the mind with the word of God. Amen. That's how you transform your mind. You have to get new data. The word is new data. your mind is sort of like a hard drive. And you have to delete the old data by inputting new data, which is the word of God. Because you'll be thinking on the word of God, not on your old coping skills, how you used to react. Are y'all getting this? Yeah. So the more words you read, the more words you put in your mind, right, the more transformation comes to your mind. Real simple. And when you delete your hard drive and put it in the trash can, if you don't delete the trash can, it's still there.
Right.
And many of our, watch this, sometimes your mind can freeze because you got too much in it. Yeah. I've noticed sometimes, I maybe because this, you got to be over 50 to understand this. I went to McDonald's one time and looked and forgot what I wanted to order. Mine just freeze because I'm just thinking about so much stuff. It just got locked. I was like, hold up, I gotta slow down a little bit. Anybody ever been there? You got so many things going on that you forget. And like I said, some of it is that I'm over 50. You know, you look for your glasses, they're on your head. Anybody get that? Oh, I like her. She with me. You go upstairs and forget what you came up there for. Right, you got right. You know what I'm saying? It's in your hand. Like, you know, that may be the over 40. Is that an over 40 crew? It's 32. Oh, he pointed and said, that's her too, Pastor. He throwing her under the bus. She can't remember nothing, Pastor. Boys go to daddy get the phone. Hallelujah. All right, that's enough of that. Let me great close. 8:18. So I'm gonna skip a lot of this. Holy living and plugging in revolves around the worship of God. It revolves around the wisdom of God. And lastly, the will of God. The will of God. Say that.
The will of God.
It's right in the text. The B clause says, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Closing, but having told us that the secret to a holy life revolves around worshiping God through the sacrifice of the body, developing the mind of Christ, Paul moves on and tells us that accomplishing these two things in our lives will enable us to carry out God's will for our lives. As we yield our bodies and our minds to Him, His will becomes more clear and more important to us. I discovered that through the experiences of life, God grows us and matures us so that when His will is revealed, we are ready for whatever He calls us to do.
Amen.
When the world sees you and me living lives that are absolutely spiritual, they know that we are transformed by the power of the gospel of grace. We will be proof positive to a doubting world that God can take the worst of us and make the best out of us to the glory of God. We must remain stay plugged in to the power of surrender. Surrender, man. Your body's under God. I preached this several times in different ways. I thought it would be important for us because we're dealing with plugging in the power and being able to be connected. And as it would deal with last week with our witnessing coupled with understanding why we do what we do. We don't get the mind straight, we won't be able to be in the certain places we need to be in to even witness the Lord Jesus Christ. So Father, we thank you even on tonight that your word is still true. Thank you for a night of teaching and understanding. Pray that somebody was uplifted, they got some knowledge. Even tonight they showed up, they presented their body, so they're living the word even right now. So even help us even to go further that your word is true. In Jesus' name, amen. Come on, clap your hands.
Amen.
We want to give and go tonight. Real good night. It's good to see y'all tonight. Y'all look, y'all, anybody, y'all tired?
Yes.
I could tell. I was force feeding a little bit, so. It'd be like that some nights, but God is good, amen.
All the time.
Some nights be, but you keep on going anyway. Don't let your next coming steer you into thinking that